What I want to talk about is just what I've done so far in my master thesis, with the final goal to get a good numerical representation of the quenching process. So the agenda, I just want to say a few words of Leiber group, then what is the motivation for me to do such a topic, then the experimental setup and these results, as well the computational setup and the results, and last the summary and the outlook. So first, Leiber group, we have two production sites in Europe. One is in Germany, in the south of Germany, which is the headquarter, and another site in Poland, in Rudaslaska. In 2018, we had a turnover of about 140 million euros, around 1,000 employees, and around 19,000 tons of aluminium per year. So again, we have 70 CNC machining processes, machining centers, and 20 forging presses. And four of these presses are completely linked, such as with afterward heat treatment process. So the sales field forecast is 80% in the automotive part, also including the motorbike area, then machining, engineering, medical engineering, and some mobility systems, just containing some seat structures for aeroplane seats. We entire the whole process chain, starting from the development of new processes or designs, then the product and process designs, forging, machining, and assembly. Our mainly used aluminium alloys are the classical 6000 aluminium alloys and the 7000 for the aeroplane parts, and these two alloys are just modified 6082 alloys, and just a narrow tolerance band of the of the ingredients of the alloy. So now to my motivation. First of all, I needed a topic for my master's thesis, and then I want to determine the distortion which caused by the quenching process, then the to get a better understanding of the quenching process itself, and last but not least, we can improve the quenching process to via the temperatures, orientation of the parts, or pre-cooling operations. So I guess this picture shows really good what quenching does. So that's the initial form of the front yoke, and after 8 times quenching, it deforms a little bit. So it looks like a tree in the wind. So then the experimental setup. To get good reference database, it's important to define. I defined 8 points in that case. So 3 in each of the legs, and some points here, and that are very special. Points are very interesting points, because during the quenching process, the yoke is tilt of around 25 degrees, and here there are some pockets where during the quenching process the vapor is trapped in. So especially point 4 and point 7 has another behavior in cooling. I've done the experimental setup just via thermocouples at each measuring point, then repeated this experiment 8 times just for get rid of some uncertainty, and go for sure that there's a constant speed of each experiment, so at around 0.15 meter per second, and therefore we have used this pneumatic cylinder. To the results itself, there are these kinks in the curves. They are mainly caused by the Leidenfrost effect, so from the film boiling, and then the kink and in that more cooling area, there's the nucleate boiling phase. And especially these lines here, 0.4 and 0.8, these are just over the 0.7 and 0.4 in that case, where the vapor is trapped in. So there's not the classical point from change from the film boiling to the nucleate boiling. All of these results, also I get 8 times that kind of diagram, and for each point, for each line, I have to get a good reference for my numerical model. So I have switched the lines just over each other to get a good repeatability, and so I can't I could eliminate the measuring artifacts like this temperature increase, which is not really realistic during a cooling process. Then for validating the final numerical results, I have done some 3D scans of the yolk before quenching. What is to observe is that there's nearly no distortion, and after the quenching there's the distortion, what I'm talking about and what I try to build up numerically. So the computational setup, the most important model parameters are the Cranchon temperature and its water. For the workpiece temperature is around 530 degrees, the descending velocity and the heat transfer coefficient, which has to be temperature dependent. And the goal is the best match with the experimental curves. In Forge, it looks classically like that, like a curve, so the heat transfer coefficient and dependent on the surface temperature. And I, not only have done that these calculations in Forge, as well I have done that in AVL Fire, which is a classical CFD approach, with a quenching model which transforms the liquid phase to the vapor phase, and therefore it take into account the trapped vapor in the part. That's a little bit. Another approach. So these equations, the significant parameters is just the scaling factor of these equations during the film boiling, and an scaling factor of this equation during the nucleate boiling, and a Leidenfrost temperature where I can shift that kink along the film boiling line. The results itself, I've done it for 0.1, 0.2, and 0.3 for now. So the continuous line is the experimental result. The forge result is the dashed line. So it fits quite well. And the AVL line is the dotted line, which fits a little bit better. That's in all of these 3 point the case. So for the first point, this this shape of the curvature of that line is more accurate in the simulation Then in the other two points, so especially here we have as well a curvature in the curve, and the AVL has another curvature, so just in the other way around, and therefore it is a little bit better, but the kink is not in the right area. The last point is it's not that good as I expected. So there's still some calibration work to do, and I hope I get better results for that. Here just some videos of the forge temperature plot. So what we can observe is that the upper leg moves a little bit during the cooling, so that's nearly the behavior what we can observe during the reprocess. And the next slide is a plot from the AVL temperature, which does not have this movement because it's just a calculation of the boundary conditions of the next simulation, where I do the thermomechanically coupled calculation for the stresses, for the stresses which causes that movement. So therefore, for now, the summary and outlook. There are still some calibration runs to do, especially for the AVL simulation. Then the AVL simulation leads to a little bit more precise results, but it's much more costly. So if you compare the run times of 40 minutes in 6 cores versus 25 hours on 14 cores in the AVL solver, there's a huge difference. Then the thermomechanical simulations are still to do from the results from the AVL, and the comparison of the measured distortion with the FEC results is as well part of the next work, what I have done. So I'm a little bit before my time, but thank you for your attention, and if there are questions, please ask.